everybody like say amen, say amen.
Amen.
Jesus, I love thee, honey.
Thank you.
Praise you. this morning. I invite you to come and bring your burdens to the Lord and cast them at His feet. You're welcome to come and pray around the altars if you'd like to. If you'd want to remain where you are, that's fine, but let's bow our heads and our hearts together today, and you may be seated as we look to the Lord in prayer this morning. Our Father, we count it a joy and a blessing that we can gather together in your house and in your name. We can gather with God's wonderful people. And Lord, we worship you. We glorify your name. We thank you, Lord, for all that you mean to us and how you blessed us, how you walk with us each day. We just want to praise your name in the sanctuary and worship you, O God, for you are awesome and mighty, and we give you glory, honor, and praise. And Father, have your right of way in this service. Open our minds and our hearts to hear from you. Draw us closer to you. Make us more like you. Let this be a day of decision when those who are gathered here and those who are worshiping with us online, that they make a decision today to live for Christ, to give their life to Jesus, and trust you as Lord and Savior. Lord, we love you. We pray that you would be with each one who is sick today. Pray for Joan Laxon today, that you'd be with her in a special way, and Caitlin. So many loved ones, Lord, we think about Carol. Touch her, Lord. Touch Diane in a special way. Lord, be with Margie's son-in-law, Darren. Touch his body. Lord, so many that have needs. You know where they are. We pray for Aretha today. Touch her in a special way. Be with Sam and Lila. Minister to them. So many, God, have hurts and needs today. And we're glad that you are the great burden bearer. And you are the great physician. And so, Lord, we just ask for your healing upon each one. We think about Lisa Justice, touch her. Bring healing to her. Lord, in this place, there may be some who are discouraged and feel lonely, maybe struggling in ways we don't know. But we're glad the Holy Spirit knows all there is to know about us. And so I pray that you would come into our minds and our hearts and speak, peace be still. The wind and the waves, they must obey your voice. So, Lord, whatever need someone has today, as they call out to you and cry out to Jesus, be their strength, their help, their stay. I know there are others that have special requests and burdens in their hearts. We agree together today concerning those needs. I pray that you would open our minds to your word, that we might hear from heaven today, that we might receive what the Holy Spirit has for his church today. Give us open minds and hearts to receive you. Illumine our understanding, Lord. We worship you. We give you thanks now for what you're doing, and Lord, for what you're going to do. For you are able to do exceeding abundantly beyond all we could ever hope or imagine. So, Lord, we pray these things in the powerful and the mighty name of Jesus. And as I reminded a whole lot of Scout families yesterday and have opportunity to remind them many times, that our church loves them and prays for them and for their children. And so, Lord, we do lift up to you all of the boys in Scout Troop 343. We lift up to you all their families, that you would be their help. I lift up to you today, Lord, those little boys in Cub Scout Pack 343. I pray for all of those girls that are in Girls Troop 321. I pray that as each one of these scouts enters this building, that they would sense there's something different here. They would sense the love of God, the peace of God, and they would be drawn to you. I pray because of the work we do and being the charter organization for all of these scouts, that there will be lives transformed and brought to Jesus because of their time here. For all of those that gather on Wednesdays and Thursdays and Friday through Weight Watchers, they're coming to a class, but may they get more. May they sense this is a place where I can be loved and accepted by Jesus, and may they be drawn to you. Father, you have put the harvest right here in our building. You brought them right here to us. Now use us as your tools to reach out and to show love and acceptance and welcome to these precious folks that you have sent our way. Have your right of way in all that we do and all that we say. May everything be done to bring glory and honor to Jesus. And we'll say yes to your will and yes to your way. For we pray this in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray. And he said, when you pray, say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you would, let us again affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. If you would read with me, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. That makes us a family of God. Come on, stand with me. We'll sing it.
Christ, I'm
God, shake hands with about 400 people. Tell them it's good to have them in the house of God today. Amen. Make sure you don't miss anybody on purpose, okay? Amen.
Just a moment to wait on us for the morning tithe and offerings, but take note of what's inside this bulletin, because there is a lot happening in the life of our church and things that you'll want to make note of, things that you'll want to be a part of. And aren't you glad that you can be here today?
Amen.
And worshiping together. It is good to be a part of a family that will last through eternity, and that's a wonderful thing. If you are visiting here with us today, if you will fill out a visitor's card, and if you will see one of the ushers or myself or the pastor, we have a gift for you. And so if you would be sure that we get your contact information, we would love to meet you and love for you to be a part of our family as well. Ushers, if you would come at this time. This is one of the... That sounded awfully sad. This should be one of the happiest times of the service for us.
Amen.
Because we have the opportunity to participate in worship through the giving of a portion of what God has already blessed us with. So I would invite you to continue to worship with us this morning as we give. Clyde, would you pray?
Father, we are grateful for your blessings of today, for your presence with us in the service, for the music, Lord, your words, your grace is sufficient for all of us, Lord.
Amen.
And we pray that on this service, pray that you will bless in each and everything. And we'll give you all the praise and all the glory. Pray for this offering, Lord. And we pray that you will bless it for each and everything that you would have it come up to. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go.
would have played that, but I don't like to show them up. Patiently, Jesus is calling you. Let nothing stand in your way. Think of the cost eternally lost, but you can be saved today.
See all of you here and welcome those who are worshiping with us online as well today, and those that will worship with us throughout the week online. And in just a short time, we're going to have new live streaming equipment, and we're going to improve our online presence for those who worship with us online as well. Take your Bibles this morning and look with me in Luke's Gospel, chapter 15. Luke's Gospel, chapter 15. Bible says in Luke 15:1, then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes complained, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. So he spoke this parable to them, saying, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I lost." Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now, we all know and appreciate the fact that enthusiasm is contagious. When you're around somebody that's enthusiastic, it just kind of bleeds over to you. You get to feeling more energized and excited when you're in the presence of someone that is just filled with happiness and enthusiasm and joy. Pastor Ed Rao once wrote about a time when he and his family went to hear a country singer performing in a live concert at a county fair. And as this singer gave her performance, she and her band, you could say, just gave technically a perfect performance. But Pastor Ed got to noticing this singer as she was singing. Yes, everything was perfect about what she was singing and how she was singing it. But he said he noticed something about her that a striking impression came on him about her as she was singing. And he said, not only is that singer tired, she is literally bored out of her mind. He said, you could really begin to sense that there was no enthusiasm in her as she sang. She sang perfectly, but there was no heart, no joy, no enthusiasm. And so it was, he said, his family left after just a few songs, and on the way home, they had the radio on, and this particular country singer's songs came on the radio. And he said he and his family, they got excited in the car. And he said, we sang her songs with far more gusto than she had in that concert. And so it was that he got to thinking about his own life, his own ministry, his own preaching. And he said, I began to wonder, do I preach bored? Do I preach with enthusiasm and excitement? He said, do I believe as I preach a message that this sermon is going to make a difference in people's lives? He said the other question that hit him was, has this particular sermon made a difference in my life? He said, if I can spend hours praying and working on a sermon and over a Bible passage and yet it go by without making a difference in my life, then maybe I'm not preaching with enthusiasm. He said of himself, he said, I can fake sincerity pretty well. But he said, contrived passion is an ugly thing to watch. And as we look at this passage of Scripture today, we might want to consider the huge difference between fake sincerity and real passionate enthusiasm. We see where the Scripture begins that Jesus talking about the tax collectors and the sinners all gathering around to hear Jesus. And while all the sinners and the tax collectors, who just as well as to be a sinner because they were the outcast, nobody likes a tax collector. You have any friends that works for the IRS? No, I didn't think you did. You see, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they began to mutter around and they said, look at that Jesus. Look at that man. He loves sinners. He welcomes sinners and eats with them. A little girl was telling her Sunday school teacher, she said, teacher, she said, my name is in the Bible. And she said, no, honey, it's not. She said, nowhere is the name Edith in the Bible. And she said, oh, but I take you back to Luke 15, where Jesus loveth the sinners and eateth with them. So here's all these tax collectors, these sinners, and they're just anxious to go out and hear Jesus teach and preach. But why? Why do tax collectors and sinners gather around to hear Jesus? Wasn't he a rabbi? Weren't the rabbis the religious elite? And were not these sinners and tax collectors unclean? Were they not religious outcasts? But you see, some rabbis were so devoted to protecting the holiness of God's word that they refused to teach those that they considered unclean. Dane and I have said for years that too often here in America, because this is not where the Church of the Nazarene or Christianity is growing. It's growing in our world areas. You go to Africa today and you'll see people packing in buildings, COVID or no COVID, because they want to get close to God and hear God and be with God's people. And we have said for many, many years that here in America, we try to preserve the gospel. So see, it's really her statement, not mine. I'm just trying to cheat a little. We seek to preserve it like it's going to go away. So we got it, and it's up to us to keep it. We're going to preserve it. We're going to put it in a lid and in a box or jar and screw down the lid, right? We want to hold on to it. It's precious, and we know it is, and we want to hang on to it. In the world areas, what do? They propagate the gospel. They say, this is such good news. We can't hold it. We can't contain it. We've just got to share the gospel. It's the same way here with Jesus talking to these tax collectors and to these sinners. Though they were considered by the church people as ungodly and outcasts, but yet Jesus is all about propagating the gospel, sharing the gospel to other people. John Wesley, the great British pastor who started the movement that became the Methodist Church, used to tell his followers, he said, you catch on fire for God and people will come and watch you burn. And that's what Jesus did. He got on fire for God and people came to watch him burn. At least some people did. The tax collectors and the sinners, they were anxious to get near Jesus and to hear him. But the religious leaders, they were trying to preserve the gospel and protect the gospel from such ungodly outcasts as that. And they griped that this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. I know of a church on the Alabama North District that is closed and sold today. I knew the pastor because he tried to propagate the gospel, and it wasn't the kind of people that that church wanted. And so they lost the sinners and the tax collectors, and they lost their own church because of their stubbornness to not propagate the gospel. Think about this. There's a guy named Mark Horowitz, and he's an artist and photographer based in Los Angeles, and he was doing a photo shoot for the home decor store Crate and Barrel you've heard of, and there was a whiteboard in this photo shoot, and it was just plain, and it was ugly, and it needed something on it. So Mark Horowitz, before he began that photo shoot, he wrote on that marker board, he said, "Dinner with Mark," and he put his own personal cell phone number on that board and then took the picture, and it was published. And it wasn't long that after a little while, people began to call that number that they would see in the magazines or wherever it was published. Not only were just a few people calling, 30,000 people called his personal cell phone number. And each time, he answered. And he spoke to those people. And how joyful they were that a live person answered that phone. They couldn't believe it. And so not only all that happened, but he decided he was going to start a new project, and he called it the National Dinner Tour. So he traveled all over the country, and he went to those people's homes, and he had dinner with them, or he took them out and visited with all those people. And what did he learn? He said he learned from sharing meals with so many strangers that a lot of people are very lonely and they just need somebody to talk to. Someone, a live person, to reach out and connect with. Can you imagine the loneliness of the tax collectors and the sinners? I imagine they just wanted to reach out and to connect with a live person. Somebody that would care about them and love them. So our Bible passage says that Jesus tolerated the sinners and the tax collectors. No, I read that wrong. It says Jesus confronted the sinners and the tax collectors with their sin. How horrible of you to be a sinner. Nope. That's not what it says. What does the Bible say? It says Jesus welcomed the sinners and he ate with them. And you know what? That offended the church folks. It offended the religious leaders. And it's easy for us to look at this passage of Scripture and feel kind of smug and self-righteous today because we think we're on Jesus' side. But what kind of people offend you? I was pretty dumb in my first church, not as dumb as they thought I was, but I was kind of dumb in my first church. And I said to them in a meeting, I said, "What kind of people do you want to come here? Let's find our target audience and go for them and try to reach them for Jesus' sake." And rightfully and, you know, honestly, I think they meant what they said, but they really didn't understand what they were saying. They said, "Well, no. We don't want a target audience. We just believe everybody is welcome." I said, "Okay, that's fine. But when everybody comes, are you going to let them sit beside you in church? When everybody comes, are you going to invite them into your homes for," you know, back then it was the old days when we had Sunday night church. "Are you going to have them over for Sunday night fellowship after church? If they don't smell right, look right, dress right." You see, Jesus welcomed the sinner. And when Jesus wants to get a point across, he usually will tell one, maybe two stories. But in this chapter in Luke 15, it's unique because Jesus gives us three stories on the same theme, and that is God loves unconditionally.
Amen.
End of point right there. God loves unconditionally. So it's not just us inside the church walls who preserve the gospel. God loves those who will never walk in our doors. Can you imagine that? How dare you? God loves those who have wandered away, who have strayed away. We may have given up on them, but God never does. And so God goes out searching and looking for those who are lost, who are disenfranchised, who are hurting, who are rejected. God goes looking and searching for those people. Why? Because God loves us unconditionally. And if God loves unconditionally, we must learn to love ourselves and others unconditionally. Amen. You see, that's why in front of some beer joints, bars, pool halls, whatever you want to call it, there are more cars today at this hour than are parked in front of this church. Because people want to go, like the song says, where everybody knows their name. I get so tickled. Somebody's been coming to church here for 10, 15 years. What's their name? We know names because we want to know names. Amen. Amen. So here we have God loving us unconditionally. We must learn to love others unconditionally. We owe the lost, the tax collector, whatever you want to call, we owe them love and acceptance into the kingdom. Amen. And into the family of God.
Amen.
Not, well, you got my seat, I guess I'll go over here. I loved it in the year 2000. We moved out of the sanctuary where we were pastoring. We had renovated over several months our gymnasium. That is still their sanctuary now, 22 years later. But when we made them do the Jericho March on Easter Sunday morning, leaving the old Cracker Box sanctuary and moved them into this big, expansive, multi-purpose sanctuary, gymnasium, you name it, it was that. The beautiful thing about that day was nobody could say, you're in my chair. Because they'd never sat in that chair. Nobody had sat in those chairs. And they had never seen it arranged like that. So it was all a brand new day. Oh, I love those kind of days. So one of these days, we're going to take all these chairs and we're going to move them over to this side. And we're going to take all these chairs and we're going to move them over to this side. And nobody can say you're sitting in my chair because your chair got moved. Now, we read earlier these parables that Jesus taught. We see that a man lost 100 sheep. When he found it, he put it on his shoulders, rejoicing in verse 5. And he calls all of his friends and says, rejoice with me. And then verse 7 says, there's more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99. And then we see in verse 8, a lady had lost some silver coins. And she had to light a light, sweep the house, that probably didn't hurt, and then search carefully until she found it, and she says, rejoice, rejoice. You see, what this is telling us is that God takes pleasure in finding lost things.
Amen.
Primarily, lost people.
Amen.
Because things don't matter. People do. God came looking for you. God came looking for me when we were lost, when we were undone, when we were separated from Him, when we didn't deserve grace. God sent grace. Amen.
Amen.
And Jesus came to show us God's love and to restore us to God by taking away the penalty of sin and death that separates us from God. There's a great little story that happened in a church one Sunday morning. The pastor announced that a little boy named Crockett had decided to become a follower of Jesus Christ that morning. So this four-year-old little boy, he suddenly stood up in his pew and he pumped his fist in the air and he shouted, "Yay, Crockett! Yay, Crockett!" Well, that's what the angels would be doing, right? No, as Mama said, you might be a Christian now, but you're in church, so sit down and be still. You know, I think we've sat down and been still long enough. I think we ought to go back to getting excited about people getting saved and realizing that's the most important thing that could happen in a church.
Amen.
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 Are y'all all right out there?
Amen.
God takes joy in being in relationship with his people.
Amen.
God is pleased when we're walking in the light as he is in the light. God takes pleasure in a relationship and it's joyful. There ought to be joy unspeakable and full of glory in our hearts and lives.
Amen.
Yeah, when Dana says this is the greatest time of the service when we take up the offering, and sometimes we act like it's not. We sounded like me a while ago. But God takes pleasure and joy in this relationship. So what's standing in the way of us coming to God? What holds us back? God is looking for lost, wandering people. Jesus used the word repent 2 times in these verses. There will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner. You know, we sometimes think, you know, when we get to church on Sunday mornings, God must be awfully proud of us. And maybe he is. But he's really happy when one lost sinner returns and comes to Jesus. We need a transformation in our thinking about God. For if we really understood God's nature and God's purpose for our lives, we would not let anything stand between us and God. We would sing, "Nothing between my soul and the Savior."
Amen.
All it takes is believing that Jesus is God. And you ask Jesus to come into your life and change you and make you like him. Guess what? You don't have to clean up your act to come to God. That's the good news. You come just like you are. Because guess what? You can't get clean enough for God.
Amen.
He's got to do it. And if you'll come to God, he will in no wise cast you out. But there will be rejoicing and celebration when one lost soul comes to Jesus. So sinners and tax collectors and down and outers, whether you are or you feel that you are, you need to come home to Jesus.
Amen.
Those of us who know Jesus, we need to be ones who are propagating, giving away the gospel. As Phineas Brzee said, "I am indebted to give every man the gospel in the same measure that I've received it. And I've received it 100-fold, so have you." And so we need to tell others the good news of Jesus. Because through it all, God goes searching and looking, trying to find those whose hearts will turn towards him. In 1997, a 2-year-old Chinese boy named Guo was kidnapped from his parents' front yard. 2-year-old Guo was sold to another family because the Chinese government instituted their one child per family policy in 1980. Officials estimate that nearly 20,000 plus Chinese children have been kidnapped each year and sold to adoptive families. Naturally, Guo's parents were heartbroken when their son disappeared. So for 24 years, Guo's father traveled 310,000 miles across China searching for his son. He traveled all these miles by motorbike and spreading flyers with his son's picture and information all over China. And in the process of searching for his one son, he suffered accidents, broken bones, even was attacked by robbers. He spent all of his family's life savings. He slept under bridges and he begged for money and did all he could. But while he was searching for his son Guo, he helped 100 other families find their kidnapped children. But he didn't stop looking for Guo. In July 2021, with the help of DNA tests, Guo's father finally found him, and he was working as a teacher in a different province over 400 miles away from his family's home. TV crews were there the moment that Guo and his weeping parents were reunited, and I'm sure it was a joyous occasion. It would be. But my friends, that pales in insignificance to compare to the joy in heaven when one lost sinner comes to Jesus. Amen. Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. I've said this before, I say it again. Every story of Jesus tells us a glimpse into the heart of God. If you want to know God's character, God's nature, God's priorities, read his stories. Amen. It's not hard to see the primary theme in these two stories is that God loves us unconditionally. And that God takes great joy in having a relationship with us. And can I tell you, God is still searching and looking and knocking on hearts' doors to see if someone will open their heart and let him come in. The question of the day is, do you want to be found? If you want to be found of God, he's ready and willing and able to bring you into his kingdom, to come into your heart and set up his kingdom in you and fill you with all the good things of heaven. Amen. The question is, do you want to be found? Because for those who will find Jesus, those who turn their lives over to Jesus, Jesus said there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 persons who need no repentance. So we want to see heaven shout and celebrate and party. We go looking for souls. And lost souls will come looking for God. And say, Lord, here I am. I find you. You find me. I want this relationship with you. God's looking. Do you want to be found? Maybe you're like the song that says, Lord, I've wandered far away from home, but now I'm coming home. If that's your plea, that's your prayer, that's your petition, you come to him. You step out, you come to this altar. You only take the first step by yourself. He'll walk with you the rest of the way. Amen. You got to step out. You got to mind God. You got to trust God and give him your heart and your life. If you're looking for God, he's looking for you. If you're not looking for God, he's still looking for you. Amen. Will you come home? Will you come home? Heavenly Father, we pray that in these moments, you would speak to us where we are, oh God, that you would minister to us and tap us on the heart today, oh God, and help us to know that we've not gone too far, but what your grace can bring us back home. Lord, we may have wandered out, but God, you know where we are, and you're inviting us to come home today. And those who are at home or wherever they are watching this service today, if they've wandered far away from you, then Lord, I pray they'll come home right there where they are, in that car, in that home, in that office, wherever they are, and they sense your tugging on their heart, then let them come home. Guide them home today, that there'll be rejoicing in heaven. We're glad we serve such a joyful and a loving God who loves us. Lord, help us to not preserve, but to propagate the good news of Jesus Christ, to tell others about the good news. It's too good to hold it in. We must tell others and point them to Jesus. Bring us home. Bring us home. You're here this morning, where you are, you want to pray, these altars are open for you. You come as we stand together and sing.
I wander
far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The mess of sin, too long I've trod.
King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed. Thanks for being here.